Good morning. Welcome to Earl Street Baptist Church. We are so glad that you are here with us this morning. We are especially glad to have you if you are a guest with us this morning. We would encourage you to look in front of you in the pew pockets located there are guest cards. We'd ask that you take one of those guest cards out, that you would fill it out, and then drop it in the offering plate when it's passed later on this morning in the service. We just want you to know how very glad we are to have you with us this morning. We want to remind you of our church-wide picnic. It will be this afternoon at 5 o'clock at Butler Springs Park. We ask you to bring a very well-filled picnic basket, enough to feed your family and then to share with others. And then make sure that you bring your checkbook or some cash with you so you can buy some dessert from the GA bake sale. Again, that's at 5 o'clock this afternoon at Butler Springs Park. Our flu shot clinic is going on until 12 o'clock today. If you didn't have an opportunity to get your flu shot before you came in to worship, the pharmacist giving the shots will be down there until 12 noon. It's taking place in room 200, which is a small conference room located in the new building on the second floor behind the elevator. We also continue to need volunteers to help with our fall festival, which is scheduled for Friday, October the 27th. If you can help and volunteer in any way, if you would reach out to Brantley Shugart or to Bethany Hovis, they would love to hear from you. And then next Sunday, we're going to be having our fall newcomers class. We'll have it for 4 Sundays during the month of October. We will be meeting during the 9:15 hour, and we'll be meeting on the third floor in the new building. There are 3 classrooms there on the third floor, and we're going to be meeting in the middle classroom. The newcomers class is designed for folks who have recently joined our church or perhaps have been visiting for a while. It's an opportunity to learn more about how our church is organized, to meet our staff, and to learn about the ministries and the activities which you can get involved in here at Earl Street. So if you are new or have recently joined or have been visiting, we would love to have you join us starting next Sunday morning, again during the 9:15 hour on the third floor in the new building. Also want to remind you that next Sunday will be World Communion Day. That's the day when we join with believers all around the world to celebrate communion. We'll be having communion during both services and our worship services next Sunday morning, but then next Sunday afternoon, we're going to be taking communion to our homebound members, folks that are not able to join us here and take communion here in the sanctuary. We would love to have as many of you join us to help with that homebound communion as possible. We'll be gathering downstairs in the fellowship hall at 2 o'clock next Sunday afternoon. There'll be information in the newsletter this week, but if you could join us on Sunday afternoon at 2, that would be great. I promise you, you will be blessed as you bless others that are homebound. Also want to remind you of the Senior Adult Retreat coming up on October the 18th. There's an article in the newsletter this week, as well as an article in your bulletin this morning. Make sure you check out that information. And you can see Chuck if you've got any questions or you want to get signed up. Lucy and Tommy are away on vacation today. We want to pray that they have a safe trip, a restful trip, and that they'd return to us safely. And then as I'm going to call Chuck to come forward and make a brief disaster relief announcement, I'd ask you to take this opportunity to take your cell phones out. Make sure you have them on vibrate or on silent.
Good morning. As you know, we've been keeping our eyes and ears open for opportunities to help and to show the love of Jesus to people affected by the recent storms and flooding. And we were notified late this week of an opportunity to help. The Greenville Baptist Association works in conjunction with South Carolina Baptist Disaster Relief. And as we've said previously, they do a great job of getting help to people who need it. And they deployed this week their first mud out team to help clean up in the wake of the floods in Sherrall, South Carolina. And that team reported that a great way to help is to provide gift cards to give to families who have been affected by the flooding. What happens sometimes in these situations is in the local economy, stores shut down and they lose business, and then people start donating things and there's not a lot of stimulation of the local economy. And so these gift cards provide an opportunity for stores to open and do business and for people to get their own supplies, and the stores are open. And so they're asking for gift cards from places like Walmart, Lowe's, Home Depot, CVS, Walgreens, or just Visa gift cards. And you can turn those in to the church. The deadline, it's a quick turnaround because they're deploying another team later this week, and they're going to take those cards and give them to families who need them. So the deadline is Wednesday. And if you'd like to participate, you can bring your gift card to the church office Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, or bring them to prayer meeting on Wednesday evening, and I'll be there, and you can give them to me. Somebody's already given me one this morning. So it's a way to show the love of Jesus to our neighbors who are hurting. So there's going to be more information on our website and on social media. Or if you have any questions, contact me. Thank you.
Please join me in the call to worship. Loving God, how good it is to know persons who love us and care for us.
Sometimes we like to imagine we are completely independent.
But then we remember people who, through your eyes of grace, see something in us we didn't see in ourselves.
So many have given us so much.
So many have cared unconditionally.
So many have lifted us in prayer.
For all who have shaped us and supported us, we give you thanks. Amen. Dear God, we come to you in worship this morning with thanksgiving and praise for the people that you have brought into our lives, who have shaped us, cared for us, and loved us unconditionally. We think about our families who raised us, our close families, our extended families. We think about our church families and our teachers. And Lord, we think about the families that we reach today that we're part of as adults or as children. We thank you so much for all the individuals that you bring into our lives and how you can work through others and they can be your hands and feet for us. And help us to be that for others in our lives as well. We pray in your name. Amen.
Praise God.
think I have a box here this morning. We're doing Operation Christmas Child. That's exactly right. And that's a sample of our box, or one box. We are doing the same thing in Operation Christmas Child and having the same theme that our church here has. We are to love God, love our neighbors, and make disciples. And that's what Operation Christmas Child does, exactly. When the children receive a box, they also receive this, which is the greatest gift. And it tells all about Jesus, because Jesus is the greatest gift that any of us can ever have. And it's in color. Some of the children, this is the only thing beside the box they have in their homes that are colorful. I was talking to a girl who had gotten one about 3 weeks ago. She told me that until she got the box and that pamphlet, she didn't have anything in her house that was any color other than black, white, and tan. Now, we have all kinds of books that are colorful. We have clothes that are colorful, but that was what she had. Not only do they get those and go through them, but the teachers lead them in those. And then they go home and tell their parents all about them and let their parents read them. The children are invited to attend a 12-week session, which is about the greatest journey. And it tells all about the Bible from the beginning until the end. It tells about God's creation, Adam and Eve, Jesus' birth, his life, his death, his resurrection. And I know some of us have been studying Zacchaeus in Sunday school, so it tells all about Zacchaeus, too. It tells all kind of things. They are taught that by their teachers when they go every week. And then when they finish and they graduate, they are supposed to go home and tell at least 9 people about Jesus and what he does. And that means that a whole community can learn about Jesus through one simple box. But think if everybody did that received a box. At graduation, they receive a Bible in their language. Now, since I speak English, I have an English Bible. But they receive it in their own language. And when they graduate, they get to wear graduation outfit. They get a diploma. And sometimes that is the only graduation that they have. A lot of these children don't get to go to high school and graduate. So I brought some pictures. You see them getting their boxes. You see the greatest gift and the greatest journey. And down here on the bottom, we have their graduations. And see how they're dressed up for their graduations? For those in our church, we have our boxes, our Operation Christmas Child boxes down in the fellowship hall. And we hope everyone will take several boxes, not just one, but several. And then we will have our packing party on October 21st. But hopefully you'll pack those boxes and then bring them, and then we can pack even more on the 21st. Let's pray to God. Our Father and our God, thank you so very much that you let us participate in Operation Christmas Child, that they have the same thing that we do at church, to love you, to love others, and to make disciples. Thank you. In Christ's name, amen. And I've got a little gift for each one of you as you go. And Miss Bethany's going to help too.
Thank you. Let's go to the Father in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning as we so often do, with our worldly offerings to you, also knowing that the offering you truly seek, the one you alone are worthy to receive, is our very lives. Daily we thank you for our health and ask your forgiveness for our sins. Today we ask that by the Spirit we would remember that our true sickness is in fact our sin, and your true healing is by grace your forgiveness. May our prayers be accompanied by the faith to know that you hear them and the confidence that you will answer. And to that end, I pray that we would find our hearts ever more purified by our presence with you. And with our material gifts and our innermost hearts, may we be fountains of blessings to those we encounter. Led by your Spirit, we pray. Amen.
Thank you. This morning we conclude our series of sermons from the letter of James with the passage that many Baptists have a particular hard time with. And so I invite you to follow along or listen as I read from the letter of James, chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. And pay careful attention to the questions in this passage, because these questions are for you and for us all. These are the words of James, and this is the word of God. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Study after study has shown that the primary reason why people outside the church are so skeptical of believers is not that our message is unbelievable. It's that we are unbelievable. Too often, people do not see us in the church as being real or transparent. And that is because we either hide our brokenness by keeping our faith private, or we display our virtues and put on a show. Either way, too many of us find it too risky to be vulnerable with God or with each other. But in this passage, the letter of James reminds us that we always relate to God as believers in the context of a community of faith. Whether we like this or not, when we belong to God, we belong to each other. And most often, many of us find God most clearly when we quit hiding and quit pretending and openly admit our need for God and our need for each other. My brother Howell, who was in the earlier service, is 6 years older than I am, which means that when I was 15 years old and had my driver's permit but not my license, Howell was 21, and by legal standards was supposed to be a mature adult who was qualified to sit in the front seat with me and help me learn how to drive. It was a welcome relief for me because most of the time my daddy was in that seat, and I was a nervous wreck because of all of his many virtues, patience was not one of them. And so as nervous as I was in driving, I was not nearly as nervous as Daddy was. Let's just say he did not have a lot of confidence in my ability to drive. and didn't until the day he died, actually. In fact, I remember as I was learning how to drive, and I would be like timidly taking my foot off the brake to put my foot on the accelerator before my foot could even touch the accelerator, my daddy would yell in an impatient tone, "Creep! Creep!" I can still hear that tape playing. When I was learning how to drive and daddy was in the passenger seat, I would have to speed up to stop. I mean, he wouldn't even let me approach the speed limit. And he would yell out, "That's the speed limit, not the speed requirement." And that's why I always like to have my older, irresponsible brother in the car with me instead of my father, because about all the advice I would get from Howell was, try to keep it between the ditches. It's a wonder I survived my adolescence. Looking back on it, Howell's advice was probably not all the advice I needed and probably was not the best, most responsible driving advice I ever received. But when it comes to living, that is pretty good advice, because most paths we travel in life have a ditch on either side. To be vulnerable, as James teaches us to be in this passage, we will have to stay on a path between two ditches. The first of these ditches is the ditch that I'm calling individualism. Some of us have been conditioned to believe that because faith is personal, it is also private. And so we will often say, my faith is between God and me, or no one else belongs in my relationship with God. If I want to have a relationship with God, I will have it on my terms, in my own way. God and I have a mutual understanding. Our favorite song is "In the Garden." I come to the garden alone. My relationship with God is none of your business. You stay out of my faith, I'll stay out of yours. The ditch of individualism. But there's another ditch on the other side of this path of vulnerability that I'm calling the ditch of hypocrisy. And that is, I'm not going to hide my faith from you. I'm going to display my faith to you so that you will see what a good Christian I am. I want to put on a show. I want to publicize my Christian values, and social media is the perfect way to do it instantly. I want to hold myself up as a model of what it means to be a believer, because down deep inside, I want you and I need you to believe that I am better than I really am. The ditch of hypocrisy. To be vulnerable, whether we're talking about vulnerability with God or vulnerability with each other, to be vulnerable is to stay on this path between individualism on one side and hypocrisy on the other. And in the verses we have read, James gives us some instructions about how to do that. But before he goes there, he reminds us that before we can ever expect to be vulnerable with each other, we have to learn to be vulnerable with God. And the primary way we are vulnerable with God is to pray for ourselves. Asking others to pray for us is important. Asking others to pray with us is important. But there is no substitute for praying for ourselves. Are any among you suffering for any reason? James said, then you should pray. Are any among you cheerful, then you should sing songs of praise. Suffering people are in the best position to realize their utter dependence on God and on each other. When life is good, we should sing songs of praise and acknowledge openly that God is the source of all of our blessings. But when we are suffering, we should open our hearts to God in prayer, directly to God, because prayer is the primary way that we can be vulnerable to God. After all, God knows us anyway. God knows our hearts. God knows what we're going to say before we even say it. We may as well start by coming clean with God. But then James goes on to describe the ways that we can be vulnerable with each other. Are any among you sick? Then they should call for the presbyters or elders of the church. Now, by the time the letter of James was written, apparently there were special representatives of the church, perhaps elected, perhaps appointed, who were called elders or presbyters. And they were chosen to intercede on behalf of the church to God and on behalf of God to the church. These elders, as the name implies, were probably older leaders in the church who were seasoned in their faith and were deemed to have a certain measure of spiritual depth and maturity. In this case, the elders were supposed to be called upon by the sick person to perform two functions: intercessory prayer and anointing with oil, which was a symbolic act combining the name and power of the Lord in prayer and a common medicinal remedy like oil. It was the ancient way of recognizing what we moderns would call holistic medicine, acknowledging that regardless of the method used, all healing, all health, and all strength come from the Lord. But sometimes they come from the Lord through medicine. There was also a recognition of the connection between body and soul, a connection that many of us have not even begun to consider. The prayer of faith offered by representatives of the church has the power not only to heal the sick person, but did you catch this when we read the passage? The prayer of faith also has the power to save the sick person and even mediate that person's forgiveness of sins. That is a radical claim when you think about it. But as my pastor used to say, look it up. It's in your Bible too. There is an unmistakable connection between a person's physical well-being and a person's spiritual that most of us have never even begun to tap into. We owe it to ourselves and we owe it to each other to recognize the mystery of how our prayers can combine with the practice of medicine to bring healing to both body and soul. We all have witnessed people who have experienced healing because of the powerful combination of prayer and medicine. It does not always happen that way, and I wish I could explain the mystery of how and why some people who are prayed for are healed and some people who are prayed for are not. But the mystery of why and when it does not happen does not remove the mystery of why and when it does happen. That is why we take so seriously the privilege and the mystery of prayer. Through it, God gives us the opportunity of participating with God in what God could do without our participation. Every time we ask someone to pray for us And every time we participate in the symbolic practice of anointing with oil, what we are really doing is making ourselves vulnerable to God and to each other. What we're really doing is admitting, hey, I need help. And we're demonstrating our faith that prayer sometimes releases God's power to heal our bodies outwardly. And even if physical healing does not come, prayer releases God's power to heal us inwardly and spiritually. As the choir sang over and over again, earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. But James goes on to list one other way that we can be vulnerable to each other, and that is, wait for it, listen to each other's confessions. Does that make you a little nervous? This is where Baptists really have a hard time with this passage. When we even think about confessing our sins to anybody but God, we conjure up images of a confessional booth with a priest on the other side, hearing us air out our dirty laundry and admitting our most shameful failures and confessing our secret sins. But here James says directly and clearly, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. Again, James is inviting us to see the connection between body and soul. In the first instance, we are told to pray for the sick that they may be saved. In this instance, we are told to confess our sins to one another so that we may be healed. It's not exactly what we expect or even want to hear. But confession is not just good for the soul. Confession is actually good for the body. Confession not just to God, but also to each other. Now, I will say that I don't think James is inviting you to make some kind of public spectacle of yourself and confess your sins to the larger audience. In fact, please spare me. James is recognizing the healing and cleansing value of having some believers in our lives who will serve as priests to us. People we can trust enough to admit the truth about who we are and what we have done. It doesn't have to be a religious professional. It can be. But we all need someone in our lives with whom we can be vulnerable, with whom we can be real and transparent. Someone who will listen to us. Someone who will represent God's grace and forgiveness to us so that we who are broken can be healed from the inside out and be made whole. Of course, God can forgive us directly without any kind of human mediation. But so often, in my experience, God's grace was communicated most effectively and mediated most powerfully through another person who was, in that experience, a priest to me. I cannot tell you how many times I have experienced this as I've opened up my own life to trusted believers. And as other believers have opened up their lives to me. Don't ask me to explain it, but there is some kind of mysterious but unmistakable power in that transaction when two believers decide to get real with each other. They create a channel through which God's healing streams may flow. People who have confessed to one another often find, after they have confessed, that they can breathe easier. People, after they have confessed, have reported over and over again, they can sleep better. They can love more deeply. They can forgive more completely. There's something about the power of confession that heals both our bodies and our souls. The power of God to heal and to save can be found along this path of vulnerability between the two ditches of individualism and hypocrisy. As Paul wrote to the Corinthians, God's strength is made perfect in our weakness. Precisely at the point of our greatest vulnerability, God's power to heal and to save is made known to us. Sometimes we are the ones who pray, and sometimes we are the ones who need the prayer. Sometimes we are the ones who hear the confessions, and sometimes we are the ones who need to confess. But we all need to learn how to be vulnerable to the people in our lives who will represent the grace of God to us. And we all need to live in such a way that people will trust us enough to be vulnerable to us. Something amazing happens when believers become vulnerable with other believers. When we pray for each other and with each other. When we confess our sins to each other and hear the confessions of each other. Salvation and healing and forgiveness and wholeness flow through us to each other when we become vulnerable not just to God, but also to each other. So this morning we're going to do something that we don't usually do. We want to give you this morning an opportunity to respond in the specific ways that the Scripture teaches that we should respond. First, as always, we invite you to make yourself vulnerable to God. Confess your sins to God. Trust Jesus to be your Lord and follow Him as your Savior. Trust Him to save you from your sins. You may do that right where you are. You may come forward to kneel and pray, or you can share your profession of faith with me. But I want to ask this question again. Are any of you suffering for any reason? Are any of you suffering? If you're suffering and you need to be healed, physically or spiritually, if you need healing for your body or your soul, you may come to either side of the sanctuary where either Chuck or Denise will anoint you with oil, as we do in our services of comfort. They will anoint you with oil on your forehead unless you extend your hand, in which case they will anoint the back of your hand with oil. If you would find meaning in that, and if you need healing, physically or spiritually, we invite you to come. If you are led today to confess your sins to another person, I invite you to come forward now or to confess your sins later to someone you love and trust. And as always, we invite you to join our church, as so many did in our first service, as we live out our faith, not privately, but together in community with each other. I will be here at the front to welcome you. However God's Spirit leads you to respond, I invite you to make yourself vulnerable to God and to each other as we stand to sing. It is a real joy for me to be able to present to you John Swiger, who comes today to join our church by transfer of letter from another Baptist church. John has been worshiping with us and has felt God's leadership into our church family and believes this is where God would have him to invest his life. And so we are so thankful that God has led him to us. And so if you will welcome him and do all that you can to help him find his place of service here at Earl Street, please express all of that by saying, "Welcome home."
Welcome home.
Welcome home. John, you're home, and we welcome you. Following the service, we want you to come by and greet him and introduce him and continue to do that in the days and weeks to come. In the 9:15 service, we had, I don't know, maybe 10 people to join or something close to that. And so I'm afraid if I tried to name all of them, I might leave out someone. So please look at your newsletter this week and do all that you can to welcome all of them home into our church family as well. Would you please stand for the benediction? Lord, we claim the promise of Scripture that earth has no sorrow that you cannot heal. We've seen such a beautiful display of your presence and power today as you have led us to respond in various ways to the prompting of your Spirit. We are so thankful for the people who continue to join our family of faith, believing that you are leading them to us and us to them. And this morning we thank you especially for John, and pray that you will keep your hand on him, that you will help us to be the kind of church that will welcome him and nurture him in his faith and give him opportunities to serve. I ask you, Lord, to keep him close to us and us to him, and keep us all close to you. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you and abide with you and keep you this day and forevermore. Amen.